So, then let's start. Yeah, disclaimer, you will work. I will do hopefully nothing. So this is really a workshop with exercises, etc. So it's already nice that you split up on the tables. I mean, if it's too tight, just use that table or something, but I think otherwise looks okay. What we will do is talk a little bit about ethics and software to give you the right mindset to start. And basically my intention to come up with this kind of workshop was from my experience as working as a tester in different contexts and industries, to always come to ethical situations where I have to choose what I do or what I don't do. And it was always a little bit like, I have to decide. There's nobody I could ask or maybe look up or something. So I said, okay, how other people, even my colleagues, are handling this. So how do you tackle that? How do you maybe even get aware that there might be an ethical situation? What can you do? So we will, I will hand out some exercises, which are all neutralized, so you don't see any company. But if you look at some, you will know it's from the public, it's some from my work experience, so it's a broad range. And what we want to do in this workshop is really take the time and go through it and actively argue both positions. So, and I hope that at least starts a discussion in your groups to like also maybe get into it why other people could do something obviously bad or not good. So why is it like that? So because hopefully in your teams you will also have a mix of different people, of course, so there might be discussion starting. And that is also if, I mean, you can self-organize in your table groups. If there's, let's say, one table totally Russian-speaking people, I don't mind, talk in your language. Only later when we contribute for the whole group, might be easier to switch to English. But other than that, if it's easier for you, obviously, to talk and discuss in your native language, just do it. I don't mind. So, you know, so that's what we will do. And I will hand that out and explain a little bit how I want to do that and then see what comes out of it. And we do this workshop as long as we have the energy and people are interested. So we will also have a coffee break later and see what happens. Now, homework discussion repeat. So basically ethics, what is it? So if you look or maybe have the experience about it, it's kind of a philosophy, like what is bad, how should people behave, what is a good moral way to live. And in the end, I mean, I'm not doing a university lecture, so that will be really roughly scratching the surface. But there is, maybe I show this one before, we all are influenced by different factors, that's probably not even all, by our upbringing, by the values our parents or ancestors have come, by the society. Like I'm from Hamburg, which is North Germany, which is as such more Protestant by religion, while the South, the Bavarians, they are more Catholic. So, so you have, even in one like country, you have different influences depending where you grew up. Neighbors, your friends, are one factor, school, upbringing, etc. That all comes as an ethic and forms what you as an individual have as a moral. Like, do I decide I cross the road even if the traffic light is red? So is it moral, is it not? There's probably some easy or not so problematic solution. Yeah, of course I go. If the whole road is empty, why should I wait? Then if there's a little kid waiting next to me, maybe I reconsider and say, okay, let's be a good influence and not do it. So, and this is what you sometimes do unconsciously. and in the work context, we also have these. And basically, coming back to the philosophy, there's roughly three main branches, which are these basically. It's a typical, as long as the outcome is a good outcome, whatever, we help the world, we make it better, then it might be okay from this kind of ethic thinking to do bad things on the way. As long as the outcome is good, it's acceptable. And the other is more like no. As long as we do it with good intentions and with good of heart, even if the outcome is bad, at least we tried, we had good intentions. It's the other one, the actions are really more. And the other one, the virtue, is a little bit fuzzy for me. It's basically the person is the important. If I decide, or maybe it's a typical, I can look myself in the mirror, then it's okay. So, but you see there's already, even in the literature, different interpretations or different ways and streamings in it, which doesn't make it easier for us than just having a guideline, that's what you have to do. I mean, the Bible tries it with their commandments, it's one way. So, this we had. And as I said, so it also needs practice. Because some situations might be more easier to spot. I know that, for example, at least I had two companies where there was always the questions, ooh, should we work with the military? Is it bad? Killing people. Military. Yes, no. So big grassroots movements. Or other, like, should we work for certain political parties or for political parties at all? So now that's maybe more or less easy to spot situations, but others are not. Because maybe they are so small or you don't, or people don't see the bigger picture as such, like collecting data. Like in Germany, we have these car sharing, like Car2Go and whatever there is. So, and they also know which radio station I'm listening to. Why? So, and I don't want that. That doesn't make sense because we can collect it, then why not? So, and that is then like, okay, but what could happen? And that comes back to our tester. So most often we are the ones asking that what if questions. Other people in the developing team, product team, should also do it. But historically, it's more the testers who come up with these ideas. Like, should we do it in the first place? And then, if we want to do it, how we make sure it doesn't go sideways? So, practicing, that's what we want to do here. And what I will hand out is some rating sheets. So, yeah, I will just hand it out. Maybe there's even enough for every single one of you. Otherwise, because it's not a big study here, you can use one and just make your crosses and have one sheet. But what I would like to do, so we have like 10 scenarios. You can pick any one you want. Then read it, or somebody reads it loud for the whole group. And then make an individual rating. Like where, in this moment of time, after you read the description of the scenario, where would you position yourself? Would you agree what that people in the situation have done? Like, no, is it reflecting with your moral, basically? Or would it, no, I would not have done it because whatever my moral, my influences, is totally opposite. Just like that. So just make it, see, maybe already see differences in your table group already there. Like, ooh, you are here, I'm here. How come? Let's talk about it. And then the second part is that is the time box. I would say here, let's start with 10 minutes. Actively argue and write down some bullet points for the pro position against, for the decision, like why did he do it or that person. Find arguments for it. And then, of course, 10 minutes. Or as long as the energy in the group is the other position. So that even if you are on one side of the spectrum, actively force you to think about what could be reasons the opposition basically has come up with a decision. So to see how it comes. And then after that discussion round, put another cross, like maybe new information has influenced your understanding or your tolerance for different outcomes. And that is the nice part as a moderator, as a group decision, where you as a, if not consent, then at least consents, decide as a group, where would you rate yourself or as a group. Genau. So that's basically my job. We will have, and of course, if the energy runs out, there are 10 scenarios, just pick the next ones. But really take your time to discuss the both sides of it and then write a little bit the arguments on. And later we can show up if we have some outliers on one end or the other, just to give information for the whole group so that we can repeat till the break. And then I will go for the next slot. Basically, when we have come into this, what do you do if you come really to a situation where you say, that's it, I need to do the Snowden and whistleblow, what do I do? But I don't, it's probably not politically correct, but I don't want to end up in Russia as David Snowden. So what can you do internally in your company, in your context, but also externally if you say, for my moral, this is a no-go, but nobody is listening, what can I do? So I just want to give some pointers, I'm not a lawyer, but there's also different ways you could escalate within your organization or without, so to see, because that is was for me a trigger, like I can ask who I want, so nobody really has a solution, because in the end it's all kind of a personal decision. I mean, in our company we have at least a commitment from the bosses, like, okay, if you are morally not, can't work in that context, no problem, we will pull you out. But it's really not like, because that makes it hard, like a general rule, we don't work with military, we don't work with political parties. Because I was a soldier, so for me it's like, yeah, it depends. So no, I don't have trouble as such working with the military. But it depends like what we are actually doing. Is it really like an attacking system or my defense system? And that's where it starts to differentiate. Okay. Get out here. So these are the session sheets, the rating sheets. Pens are in the basket. So here's some scenarios, and I would say just for warm up, pick one scenario, then we time box it, let's say maximum 2 by 10 minutes, then we do a little round together after that, I show you another approach, how you can debate and argue, and we proceed from there on. And if there's questions, I'm around. Yes. Is every table found a scenario?
У каждого столика есть сценарий.
Did you all do your individual cross before you go into the discussion? The session sheet? Let's just pick one to start with. I've given too much freedom. Pick number one. as a group. Yeah. So, as you hear, my little timer. On the back, has each table decided at least on a scenario? You picked one. You picked one. You also found one. Good. And please just remember to make your individual crosses after you read the scenario the first time before you start basically the group discussion. Just everybody makes a cross on one page. It doesn't need to be individual. Really use one session sheet, so you can also easily see where others put their crosses. And then also the discussion, finding pro arguments and later finding against arguments can be as a group, because you really should talk and discuss and come up with ideas, especially if it's a position which is not yours initially. So, because then that's normally, you know, we heard that probably a little bit, the discussions are starting and the flow is starting. Yeah, what scenario did you pick, number one? So, you know, normally it's like, yeah, it could be maybe a little bit clearer. Then scenario one, it's push the changes, like yeah, I heard your concerns, but just do it anyway. And then it's like, depends where you stand, because yeah, the boss is right, and you have no ethical problems with it, then you're on the pro side. But the other person might be, no, that's totally, so he would be against. And as I said, you can put the argument really together as a group. Maybe somebody or one person writes, and then the other can just contribute with the arguments. So you don't need to really everybody by themselves fill it out. see the initial discussions are starting now. I would slowly come to an end for this first exercise, since the official break is coming up. So if you want to mingle with the others, we could wrap that up now as a first getting into it. Everybody found time to go through both positions, at least a little bit. Okay. Did you do your crossing? Did anything change? Was it like before? Is any table to share? Interesting. So if you're more like, what, responsible money-wise, you would have another moral than as a developer? I mean, yeah, so the switch, yes. Since it's a testing conference, I naturally would assume the testing position. But yeah, I mean, it's a good point, because that's also sometimes what people maybe inadvertently forget, that they have more than one role. They are not the developer, but maybe also society. Like, I'm also a user of certain softwares. How would it affect me or my family or something? So, but to remember to take a step back and whatever, look at the bigger picture and say, I'm not only a creator, a product owner or manager, but I'm also a human and user in the end. But thanks. How did it go on your table? 12 points. Or agree to not agree, but yeah, that's the group dynamic. Like, is it like such a no-go that you say, no, I'm not going from my position, or yes, I understand, we meet in the middle. But or one decides and that's good. Then I would like to give you just a little outlook into the next session, the next slot. course, to lure you back, good cliffhanger. What I would like to do now, after the break, is basically pick another scenario. So, from the one you haven't done. Again, do read it, maybe read it loud in the group. Then make your initial cross. Where do you see yourself? And then work through in the same format, like pro and contra. Do the things, but I will give a little insight into, this is called the Toulmin model, which is kind of a structure how you can debate or argue your points, or basically also what happens if you now maybe do it from, let's say, your gut feeling. No, we cannot go this position because it's bad. Because, so I mean, yeah, we have this feeling, but that can help to get the reasons and the influencing factors out of it. So it's a model from psychology which you can use, which I want to use in the next slot to basically force you to work in this structure. I will explain it afterward, and then go through your second scenario by that. And then there will be another approach after that when we come to the whole topic of code of conducts. So that can be another helping body which can help you defend or argue some positions. Sure. And then we will wrap it up with the outside in what do I do if I want or if I need to escalate it. Like what are some pointers, what are some tips and tricks. But the thing right now is the official break. I mean, I don't mind. If you want to stay, obviously, would be also cool for me. So, but again, that is group decisions. Plus, it's the official break. If you want to meet colleagues or others or have a coffee and a drink, it's now. Three, two, one, lock the door. Okay, then we continue. Should we continue? I mean, I don't want to continue and then... Yeah, okay, good. So, as I said, this Toulmin model... No, nothing. Yeah. Just don't mind me, it's cool. Basically, it has this structure. So what it does is basically you come up with some initial feeling or like, oh no, like let's say in this context, this software is used in military attack vehicles. That is a kind of fact, like a Volkswagen company manipulated the emission exhaust, that's a fact. And then you come to an outcome, a conclusion, saying, so people working on software which are used in military attack vehicles are murderers, bomb, by proxy or not, but that's the bottom line, that's my conclusion. So, and then why? And that feeds back into this here, warrant and backing. Because killing humans is bad. That's my moral, my ethics. And depending what your influencing factors are, you can back it by the Bible or by some governmental regulations, like in the emission case, because that is a law. And if you violate that law, that's my backing for this reasoning. So, and rebuttal is kind of conditioned. It's normally it's bad, but there's an exception, which here could be like software only, maybe it's acceptable if it's really for defense only. So then I would be okay with it. And this chain, you have a fact. It's really a fact and not fake news and shit. So, and then you need to find out why. Really think, like, why is it bad for me? What is it? Killing humans is bad. Where do I get my influences? Do I know it? Because, yeah, I can immediately have an opinion. No, this is a bad thing, that is a good thing. But then I need to, I want to reflect myself, saying why? How did it come? Maybe it's my upbringing. I was raised in a Catholic school, whatever. So, or in our community, in our society, whatever, domestic abuse is bad, it's forbidden. So really try to get it out, like what is your argumentation behind it. And then maybe even this rebuttal, like, could there be situations where it would be legal or morally okay? Is that maybe what my other party, who has done it that way, thinks or understands? So, and with this Toulmin model, try to work through the second scenario which you pick and choose. Again, make your read it loud, make your initial cross. So, and as I said, you can also do it on one paper, then it's easier to compare, because then you see like 5 or 6 crosses in one. Try to work the discussions you had for pro and for contra with these. So see, can you argue or can you articulate why you have this feeling it's good, it's bad? And can you explain it to your group, basically? Because then it helps them probably also to understand what is your reasoning behind it. And then you can see if you come to a consent in your group decision. Since we don't have a break here, should I get some water for us? Water bottle? Not yet. Good. to close the second round, how was it? Did you try to use this model? Was it different, more helpful, not helpful, same like before? How did this round felt? I mean, the first one was probably getting to know each other a little bit, so and finding in the routine as a team. But subjectively, from the sidelines, it seemed more communication than before, because the first shyness maybe is gone. Or was it just interesting scenarios you picked this time? How was it for your table? Yeah. And from your initial opinions and the group consent, was there something? Yeah? But why? You had your opinion before. No, like how come? Was it really arguments you hadn't heard? Okay. And your table, how was it this time? In your morals. Okay. And also from the outcome, some changes in what people voted before? Okay. Yeah. Good. Your table? Ah. But you could also argue the other position. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. What scenario did you choose? Okay. Smiley emoji. Good. Okay. As I said initially, it can happen often, especially or at least for me as a consultant. So I'm normally the only tester, plus I might be even an external people. But even when I was working as a regular employee, there was mostly really fewer testers than all the other people around. So it can feel like, okay, I have to do the moral decision for myself and maybe raise the issues or handle them somehow. And one step would be to see if you can build up a network of like-minded or raise it in retrospective or whatever feedback channels you might have in your team, in your organization. So to come via discussions and debating to some kind of whatever team ethic, as maybe another influencing factor besides society, etc., work ethics. And one thing could be like definition of done for the ones working in agile environments, specification documents, like a kind of written down code of ethics. So the good thing is we don't need to start from scratch. There are code of ethics. So there are actually some. Of course, the IEEE has one. Even ISEQB has one, but this half of a page is not really useful, I think. So James Bach, of course, he has an opinion on that as well. And the ACM, so which is the an industry standard or code of conduct, which is around for a long time, and they even actually modernized it. After 20 years. So this one is actually a kind of pragmatic one. So it's not totally fluffy, but also not like a big standards document. It's something which it's still a lot of text, but at least it's something which can be worked upon. So I just gave two and two. So the next exercise, maybe skim by the headlines. So there will be a test in the end. No, it won't. But yeah, maybe skim through it, check the headlines, see, and then see if the next scenario you pick, you can find arguments supporting your position in this code of ethics. So, and that might be even on a small level, when we come later to the escalation scenes, which you can start in your company, so that at least next time there is an ethical situation, you have at least some pointer what maybe your team or your company has agreed upon. It's still probably just an heuristic. It might work in your next context, it might not, but at least you have something in your hand. And I would like to wrap that up a little bit. So maybe take really like 10 minutes, 13 and a half minutes for the next exercise, debating and skimming through it. So we have a little bit, we still have sufficient time for the escalation path, which will wrap up the session, because then we are nearly here already for 90 minutes. it's always sad to interrupt ongoing discussions. But maybe to wrap that up, what was your experience, opinion now? It sounded to me like on this table you could use certain sentences and paragraphs for your scenario. What scenario you had, roughly?
I think we're finding difficult to put numbers on it, to be honest. We've got a lot of it depends on this, it depends on that. We're having a good debate about, we're talking about the smart home appliance that might crash if the update's applied. So a lot of our debates around whether the company's going to notify users, how they're going to notify users, are they being trustworthy. Yeah.
But in the end, it's a binary decision. You do it or you don't.
That's where we're stuck.
Fair enough, yeah. But you also, for me, it reads like you couldn't really find any pointer in the code of ethics which could help you make the decision.
It depends.
Even that. Okay, fair enough. How was your going?
Hallo?
Ah. Welcome.
Okay, from our point of view, the code of ethics, it's helpful, but in the end, it helps us not to change our opinion about that already, because we have already our opinion based on our education, whatever, and so it's just a guideline.
Okay, what scenario you had in this sense?
We don't change it. He was the same scenario with okay. Feelings.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, interesting. That some really found also the time to go into deep. So I had other rounds which, I mean, all the difference between a code of ethics and just you should not kill, you should not steal. So it's like documentation versus very clear. So, but that's, you need to find also for your context, like how deep is enough? Are you more in structured environments? Are it's more like just for team level? Can we live with small bullet points more or less? Or do we need like an industry-wide formulated, maybe trying to cover many situations document? Yeah, and now for the last bits, the question of escalating. So, because you might still come to a situation where you say, okay, for me, myself, I cannot live with what the team or the company has a consensus for. I mean, then you need to find out, like, how willing are you to take the consequences? Is it just finding a new job and quitting the company? Because maybe the market situation in your country and industry is good enough that you have choice? Or do you say, no, I still have the hope or the feeling I can change things, it might just take time. I want to stick it out and be the one voice calling against it and say, no, we should. So, how do you do? Between going to the press and really blowing the whistle and just internally working to improve situations as a whole spectrum. So, and that can start like on team level, just by talking, coffee talks with each other saying, hey, where do you stand? So have you thought about that? And maybe going in the organization, you can also look for like allies, like who can help me, who might have the same interest. So like HR departments or stuff like that, so, or in other forms like unions, employee committees, staff, staff with an A, so personnel who might also be more in, yeah, oh, we should see that we work in a good way and that we produce good software or stuff like that, maybe marketing or PR departments, if it's like Volkswagen or something which can blow up to the public and decrease stock values. So need to see if you can't do it, and then what also a little bit came, like how can you escalate it? Do you go directly to the responsible person, or do you skip a level in your reporting hierarchy? Would it make sense? And do you have spokespersons, especially like employee committees or unions that do something, you can tell them, and they raise the issue on higher level without actually telling the person's name, if it's possible, and not you're the only tester anyway, so everybody would know who it is. But at least there are ways. And then there's a whole change of going going public. Even there you can start small and saying, okay, maybe there's consumer protection agencies where I can raise certain issues. Or maybe there's even, especially now also like in Germany and other countries, these GDPR formal persons in the company, but also on like, I'm missing the word. Ministry level, so like really official government people who have an eye and an ear and help you out with that. So even there you can scale it. So, and the last option might be still going public to the newspapers and putting it out there. So, but in any case, get if it's really, really something, like for example, for me it was one of the scenarios. I was working with a client, banking industry, and I got to know he just used a copy of production data. So, even, also really without anonymizing it. So, and it was like, what do I do? So, I did nothing. It's not so I'm not proud about it or whatever. That's the thing. So, I don't have any feelings in that specific situation. So, it's like, okay, I tried, I raised it with him, obviously, the client guy. So, but yeah, he has other priorities and whatever. So I trace it with a company. So, and it's like, yeah. So, and for me, it's just like, okay, I did my bit. So I tried it, but in the end, it's not worth for me going public or making a big Nartag. So, but yeah, that's my decision. So I have, and I do live with it, but there might be other issues where I have more passion and say, no, 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 this is really crossing the line, I cannot do it. So, and that is maybe due to a lack also that we don't have formalized whatever spokesperson in that sense. So I overheard, when I heard that correctly, that internally some of you have something like a, however you call it, like people you can talk to. Do you have something that in your companies? So. What is it in you? Is it HR or is it something else?
So in my company, I work for a credit rating agency. So we have a policy that makes sure there is no like insider information being sold about the ratings preliminary before they published. And we have a special department that is taking all this kind of information that it might be a concern about this information being published before it was.
Okay. So it's really you could go there, yeah, and they would take it further from there or investigate?
Yeah, they will investigate it, or they must investigate it, or they also give us the contacts of EU regulator that we can also contact. But yeah, if you first contact them and then EU regulator, they will know that it was you.
In our company, we had a training in ethics because we work with really sensitive data of many, many people from around the world. And there was addresses when we can send our concerns, our ideas, and our thoughts about harmful behavior of someone. It will be anonymous. And I think it's a really good policy to teach everyone how ethically we should work.
So it's really also like active and lively. Because the other thing would be something you sign when you join the company, and then it goes in the shelf.
No,
so
we had training. We should pass, answer the questionnaire about it. But some cases we should teach. So yeah, it was quite well designed.
Yeah.
A lot of areas where, particularly in Europe, and I'm talking about the UK from my background, but there's a lot of areas where legally you have to take it to an agency that isn't your employer. Like if a child is a risk, right? It's a safeguarding issue. In financial services, there's specific legislation in the UK that if you whistleblow, if you pick up the phone to a whistleblower hotline, you get loads more rights. Immediately, your employer can't fire you.
Mm, yeah.
On the other side of the coin, I've had people call it about me one time because they didn't agree with my testing coverage. And rather than come and have a discussion with me, they picked up
yeah.
the client's hotline, who immediately descended the next day and wanted to go through everything, you know?
Yeah.
So it can be abused as well.
True, yeah. And I mean, true. But then maybe connecting to my, like, I mean, in Germany, it's obviously legally verboten, to cross the street when there's a red light. So, and then it's like, or like, because you have a contract normally, of course, with your client or with your company not to talk about sensitive stuff. But if you come into this situation, I mean, that is a Snowden case. When do you say, fuck the laws, that's not right. So I have to do it, and even if I break the law, so if you look at all the Rosa Parks movement, etc., so at one point, yeah, I mean, it's good if there's, at least on the other side, like protection laws like that. Also, at least in America, I think, in US, there's also a lot of whistleblower clauses, like similarly you mentioned, like if you do whistleblowing, you got protected work employment, so you're not fired. So if it's not abused, et cetera. But yeah. Yeah, yes, please. Yes. Yes, three. But yeah. Genau, ne, so as I said, yeah, there are some links, whistleblower protection, etc. EU is also proposing it. But yeah, so ne, these hard evidence, if it's really something where you say, I need to go public, collect the evidence, see that you get it out anonymously, not like this Reality Winner, who basically printed out on the client's printing machine, which then, of course, could be traced back to her. Don't Google how to get documents out of the company. So, yeah, this happens. Yes. No, this here also nochmal. UN, WTO. Yeah. So, we are not alone. And as a closing word of mine, even if it sounds cheesy, so I'm quite happy that you came here and choose this topic. And yeah, so, and also makes me kind of out that there are testers out there who also really consciously think about that or want to know about that. But I think on all areas, again, developer as well as testers, we could use some more focus, especially connecting to your talk in the morning, with machine learning coming up and AI, which in the end also will transfer the bias of the programmers or product owners into self-deciding algorithm in the end. So. That's about it. Thank you. Party starts in 10 minutes. There's no T-shirt here, so thank you. Is it? Oh, indeed. You want one?
No, you will have.
You have your same? Okay. No. Oh, I like that also the staff is actually participating here. Yeah. Anyone wants it? Actually, two, because I have one from the morning. Yes. Thanks. Otherwise, no raffle and lottery here. That's all too complicated. Good. I will clean up. Then maybe I'll see some of you around the party later or tomorrow.
Of course.
Thanks for coming.